talk to the Jews and have entrance into the synagogue. For some reason, you can't go into the synagogue unless you were. So, I don't know, the locker room. I don't know what it was. So they knew. So he tells Timothy because of that. Titus is a Greek. He doesn't tell him to, because he wants him to understand that salvation is not, your salvation is not based on that. Then you look in your Bible in verse 4, it talks about the false brethren. And he addresses them, these Judaizers, these sham Christians. They have developed a hybrid faith. They're not Judaizers, they're not in Judaism, because they accept Christ as the Messiah, and they are not, they're legalistic, so they're not apostolic Christians. It's impossible, Paul says in Galatians 5:2, it's impossible to be a legalist and to be a Christian. So there's some kind of hybrid faith that they're talking about. And Paul says this is how they're categorized. They sneak in and they spy out our liberty, and they want to bring us back into bondage or into legalism. They're based on earning their favor from God rather than in what God could do for them and in them and through them. So in Christ, there is freedom. There is freedom. It's not the freedom to follow this list of do's and don'ts in your life, but it's the freedom to let God flow through your life to do what He wants to do and how He wants to fulfill His work and your purpose and meaning and significance. It's allowing God to flow through you. It doesn't mean there's license to do whatever you want to do. Romans chapter 6, verse 18 says, we have been freed from sin, from the slaves of sin, and now we're slaves to righteousness. Our goal is to do what God wants us to do, is to follow His commandments, is to obey His teachings, and do what He wants us to do. In verse 5, Paul challenges them to remain in this truth. Remain in the truth. Paul says, even though I went to Jerusalem and I talked to them, I was going to remain in the truth. I knew that the truth I was preaching was the same that they were preaching, that it all went together. I'm going to remain in the truth. So he talks about his companion. Point number 3 on your outline is the commission. So if you want to write this one in, you can. The commission. The commission is found in verses 6 through 9. When Paul went to Jerusalem, it was not for approval or correction, but it was simply for recognition. He was seeing that Paul had been entrusted, he says in the text here, with the gospel to the uncircumcised, just as Peter had been to the circumcised. He says that for he, in verse 8, for he is the Holy Spirit, who energized and empowered Peter, also empowered and energized Paul. That same spirit of this one gospel was evident in both ministries and both lives. After the council, it's never questioned the apostolic, whether Paul was really an apostle or not. Apostle. Never again is it questioned. Matter of fact, in 2 Peter chapter 3, the apostle Peter confirms that everything that Paul writes, and he compares it equal with Scripture. So there's never a question between the 12 and Paul, his father, whether he was truly an apostle. The next thing Paul says in our text, he says in verse 9, he says, recognizing the grace that had been given in verse 9. The only conclusion concerning Paul is this divinely commissioned that he had to be a blessed instrument of God to preach grace. Only God's grace could account for the mighty spreading of the gospel and the building up of the church. So point number 4 is the commendation. It's in the second part of verse 9 and verse 10. He says, James and Cephas and John, they gave me and Barnabas the right hand of fellowship. These reputed pillars, he says, these great teachers and leaders, these that were the pillars that established and supported the church in perfect doctrinal harmony and in personal harmony with them, they received the right hand of fellowship. That meant the friendship, the fellowship, and the partnership. Peter was saying to Paul and Barnabas that our ministries are equal. We share the same task, the same role to do what God wants us to do. And Paul says the only thing they said was to remember the poor. And he said, this is what I was eager to do, was to remember the poor. Over and over, when you read through Paul's letters, he's constantly taking up a collection for the Christians in Jerusalem. Those, when the church began, and the thousands of those that came to know Christ, they stayed in Jerusalem. There was a great need. In Acts chapter 11, verse 28, there was a famine in Jerusalem. So Paul knew that, and he took up these offerings from the Gentile Christian churches, and he took it to Jerusalem and gave it to help the Jerusalem Christians. He was all about, that's why he says, I was eager to do that one thing. If you add that one thing, I'm eager to do it, Paul. Preach the grace of God, preach the gospel, and look out for the poor and help them in any way that I can. So now we come to the last point, the commitment. The commitment. What kind of commitment do we make concerning this passage? What kind of commitment do we make looking at this event that happened in Paul's life and how he reminisces about it and its significance and its importance? So here's what I came up with as far as my own life. The commitment to make is to the absolute authority of God's Word. I wanted you to fill in the word authority. The absolute authority of God's Word. Another way I wanted to make that statement was the absolute authority of the apostles' doctrine or the apostles' teaching. Because what we see right here is the unity among the apostles. Acts chapter 2:42, the church, when it began, they devoted themselves to the apostles' doctrine. It's what they devoted themselves. It's what they focused on. Everything that they wrote, everything that the apostles said was from God to the church. If you Google some things about stuff that the Apostle Paul would say, there are many people who try to disprove what Paul wrote. There are many people who will try to disprove that Paul and the 12 apostles were separate and they preached different gospels. They'll even use the verse that I just read to you. Peter, you go and preach to circumcised, and I will go and preach to the So there were two gospels people will try to challenge you with. False teachers will try to lead you into. All you got to do is Google it. I did it last night. And you'll see the stuff that's written to say that it's not true. It's not accurate. You and I as Christians, if you're a follower of Christ, you have to be committed to the absolute authority of God's Word in your life. Authority is what is in control and what is in charge of your life. Is it God's Word? Is it what He says? Is it His truth? Is it really the authority in your life? See, my mind goes back to Nehemiah, the book of Nehemiah. When after the 70 years of Babylonian captivity, the Jews come back to Jerusalem. When they come back to Jerusalem, they see their temple in disarray. I mean, the walls around the city are torn down, but they see the temple. And they start rebuilding the temple. And Zerubbabel starts rebuilding the temple. And they start doing this. But the enemies keep coming in and wiping them out because there's no wall around Jerusalem. And so Nehemiah sees it. He wants to do something about it. And so he plans. He goes, by God's commission, to go to rebuild the walls around God's city. So that what? They can build a temple. They can be back to worshiping God. And so he goes back to the temple. And supernaturally, in 52 days, he rebuilds the walls around the city of Jerusalem. And the last thing they did was put the doors on. And they shut the doors. And they closed out the enemies of God. And then it says that Nehemiah found the list of genealogies in the temple. That's like saying they found the Bible in the basement. The people had not known what God wanted them to do for 70 years. 70 years. It's a long time, isn't it? To not know what God's Word is. They found the Bible in the basement. They blew the dust off of it and they started reading it. And Ezra, the prophet, started preaching from it. And the people were so convicted that they fell down on the ground and started crying and weeping because they knew that they had not been doing what God had wanted them to do. And a revival broke out among God's people that lasted for years. Their statement was, they said to Ezra when they knew that he had found it, bring out the book. Bring out the book. And Ezra built a podium. It's the first pulpit that's ever mentioned of in the Bible. He built the podium. And he stood up on a stage. And he started reading and explaining the Bible to the people. The people stood while he read. Half of the day they stood. The other half of the day it says that they spent confessing their sins to God. And after this went on for days and days, because revival was coming, because when we hear the Word of God, When you hear the truth of God's word, it should stir something in your heart and in your mind and in your soul. It should stir something up. And it was doing that. Revival was happening in that city, in those people's lives. And they saw it. And immediately they go to the sin that's in their life and how they've been disobeying God. And they're confessing and repenting. And finally, Nehemiah said, "All right, we're done confessing. It's now time to celebrate the forgiveness of the Lord. The joy of the Lord is your strength." It's time to celebrate. They threw a celebration and they rejoiced in the fact that God would hear their prayers and God would forgive their sins. And then after they had their celebration, the last thing they do in chapter 9 of Nehemiah is they make a covenant to God to obey His word from here on out. So you see, the process of real revival, where the Bible becomes the absolute authority in your life, the process is you bring out the Bible and you listen to the Bible and you hear the Bible explained. You hear the Bible, you hear what's called expository preaching. You hear the Bible explained. And when the Bible is explained, it should speak to our hearts and our minds and our souls. And it should lead us to making decisions and convictions about our life and our soul and leading us to repentance. And then that repentance, we should celebrate when the truth is presented that when we confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins. That celebration. But then there's this need, this third aspect, to obey what God says. To live like He wants us to live. To do what He wants us to do. So there's the Word of God. There's confession. There's celebration. And then there's obedience. The covenant they made. That can happen in a church. It can happen in a person's individual life. Where from now on, I truly believe, I don't just make this statement, but God's Word is an absolute authority in my life. And I'm going to live by it. I'm going to trust in it. You know, James says, don't just merely be a hearer of the word, but be a doer. I'm going to do what it says. Secondly, the unity of the church is the second application or commitment to make. The unity of the church. The unity. There's the church. Here's Paul, 17 years of preaching the same gospel that the apostles are preaching in Jerusalem. There's unity in the church. There's unity in the theology of God, of who God is and the truth of God. There is unity in that message. You see, there's unity in the doctrines of the church. That's why you and I need to know what those foundational doctrines are and know them so that we can live by them and also share them with other people. You should know what the foundational doctrines are so that when you hear something false, you know that you're listening to a false teacher. But you should know. That's what unifies us. The doctrines of Christianity, they unify this church. They should unify your life as a Christian. And then lastly, to defend the gospel of grace. That third bullet point is to defend the gospel of grace. Defend. Defend grace against legalism or any other false teaching. And the only way that you'll ever be able to do that is if you're grounded in the foundational doctrines of Christianity. So you should know them. You should be able to recite them. I tell them to you all the time, the six foundational doctrines. You should know them. What are they? There's one God existing in three persons. You should know that foundational truth. If somebody ever tells you there is no Trinity, then you're listening to a false teacher and you need to stop and turn and walk away. There's one God who exists in the Bible in three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The Father is talked about as God. Jesus is talked about as God. The Holy Spirit is talked about as God. There are three persons, but they're all one God. So we believe in one God. There aren't many gods. There's only one God. Secondly, the Bible. The Bible is the inspired, infallible, inerrant Word of God. 2 Timothy 3:16, all Scripture is inspired by God and profitable. So it is. Thirdly, who Jesus Christ is. Jesus Christ is what? Emmanuel. He is God who has came and dwelt among us, died on the cross, buried in a tomb. Tomb, rose from the dead, ascended, sitting at the right hand of the Father, and He's coming again soon. Jesus. false teaching will always attack who Jesus is, and they'll say that there's no way that Jesus could be God. That's false teaching. That is the foundation of Christianity. So you know that truth about who Jesus is. He was fully God and fully man. The fourth one is the plan of salvation. How does a person come to know? How do you come to know salvation? How do you have your sins forgiven? It is by grace through faith in Jesus Christ alone. And faith is where you trust in Him. When you're willing to turn from your sins, repent of your sins, confessing before others, and you're willing even to be baptized into Him. But the plan of salvation, you know what it is. Number five is man. What do you believe about man? The Bible says all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. You and I will never be good enough to earn God's favor. We can never do enough good deeds. We can never be religious enough. It'll never work out in our life because the Bible says all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. It is only by what Jesus Christ did on the cross that you and I can experience salvation. So it's what you believe about men. We are not going to get better and better. There is no goodness in our heart. The Bible says in Isaiah, the wickedness was within our heart. There is no goodness. That's number five, right? Number six, the ordinances of the church. What Jesus specifically said, do this. He said to do this in remembrance of me. So we follow that command. We follow the ordinance of the Lord's Supper. Do this in remembrance of me. Meeting around the Lord's table. We do it every Sunday because we think that's what the church in Acts did on the first day of the week. The second ordinance is baptism. Jesus said to do this. Some churches say you don't need to do this. Some churches say you can be sprinkled when you're a baby and you're saved. Where did that come from in the Bible? It came from the Roman Catholic Church. You didn't have access to water, so they started sprinkling people. Then you say, how in the world is sprinkling a baby helping somebody be saved? If you've ever been in a christening service or a baptism, they will pronounce that baby is saved. Where in the world is that in the Bible? There's a passage in 1 Peter that says baptism now saves you. They think that baptism, regeneration, saves you. Simply the act of being baptized saves you. And so when you're a baby or a child, because you're born in sin, you need to do that so that you can be saved. That doesn't go along with everything else that's in the New Testament. Do you realize that? In the book of Acts, a person came to Christ who could repent from their sins and turn to Christ. Jesus says, go into all the world and make disciples, baptizing them. Someone has to become, or the process of becoming a disciple. They have to know what their sin is. They have to deal with their sin, turn from it, and come to Christ. It's a conscious decision that you make, and a little bitty baby can't make a decision like that. They're innocent in God's eyes. We're born with sin, and something's got to be done. What's got to be done is grace. Accept the offer of God's grace. And the Bible says, Jesus said, He went to John and was baptized. So it's something that you need to do. And every time the word baptism is used in the New Testament, it means you dunk somebody. You need to be dunked. That's why you need to do it. The Lord said to do it. He commanded us to do it. It's unthinkable of somebody in the New Testament who's either called a believer or a Christian who's not baptized. That's how significant it is. And it's part of the Great Commission. So if you've never done it, you should do it. We challenge people to do it every Sunday, every Lord's Day. The baptistry, the water, we got a little pool heater up there. It's nice and warm. We challenge you because we believe that's true. That you need to believe and trust, turn from the Lord, and be baptized. If you've never done that before, it's a foundational doctrine of Christianity. It's been messed with, of course. And I don't mean to offend you if you come from a denomination where there's sprinkling and christening. I'm just trying to tell you what the truth of God's Word is. And as always, if you want to talk to me about it, you can call me on the phone or we can talk about it. But the challenge, listen, the basic truth is that you need to be baptized. It's an ordinance that Jesus gave to the church. It's foundational truth. So based on that foundational truth, it unifies the church. The truth unifies the church, and it unifies Christians. And you can see that over and over again in this paragraph I read to you today. It's all about grace. God's favor, God's merit on those who turn to Him. Let's pray. Lord, I just thank You for Your word and for Your truth. I pray, Lord, if there's somebody here today that needs to turn to You, Lord, for the first time in their life, that they make that decision to trust You and to obey You and do what You want them to do in their heart right now and in their life. Lord, I pray for that. I pray for those that need to come join hands with us and help us build the kingdom of God here in Loganville for You. I pray that they would make a decision today to trust You and to do that even today, Lord. I pray for our decision times, that we would all make decisions to turn to You, to trust You, and to live for You in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you stand with me? And we're going to sing the song, Trust and Obey. Next Sunday. In Jesus' name, amen.